Hello and welcome back to another video with It's Dr. Dan, and today we're going to be diving further into equilibrium. So this is a follow-up video to my last video on equilibrium, which just talked about the fundamental concepts of how we can do K expressions, how essentially with equilibrium we have a forward and a reverse reaction, and we illustrate them using these expressions. So this is going to go into a little bit more of the theory behind it and how all this comes about and how it works. So when it comes to equilibrium, really, the one thing that we got to think about, it's all about achieving balance within a chemical reaction, meaning that it's sort of a battle of the rates of the reaction between the forward and the reverse reaction. So we want to try to think of how can the reaction sort of achieve its zen moment is one way to really to look at this. So if I, let's say, have this chemical reaction here, what we're trying to actually understand is it's that reactions do not react all the way to completion. Even though up until this point in general chemistry, you're always told, hey, all the reactants go to products. That's not always the case. In fact, most reactions generally fall somewhere in the middle where you will make a lot of products, but there's always going to be reactants remaining left over. Now, this can be especially true in terms of the solution phase and in gas phase reactions specifically. Now, we typically don't do a lot of calculations with, like, in terms of stoichiometry with these or anything crazy in introductory chemistry, but we do got to realize that, hey, this entire process is dynamic, meaning that's ever changing. We can try to essentially put different stresses or change the conditions of our reactions to help influence it. Can we try to push it in one way versus another? So there's all kinds of ways you can affect a reaction, right? You can change the concentration. You can increase the temperature a lot. You could maybe add an enzyme or a catalyst. You could change the pressure, the volume. All these little things will have a really big impact on this process. Now, why are chemical reactions happening? Well, when we were talking about equilibrium, is that we show these via aqueous chemicals or gas phase chemicals. So the more simple forms of chemicals, especially when it comes to gases. Now, the way that we talk about all this is kind of goes back to kinetic molecular theory, in that all these little particles, they're like little billiard balls hitting each other. Well, molecules collide with one another. Now, when they collide with maybe another reactant, well, then a reaction will happen. But the thing about it is, it's not just that simple. It needs to be in the correct orientation. It needs to have enough energy for that to happen. So one of the things that we need to think about is when we're looking at, let's say, a flask like we have right here, like on the left with all these different numbers here, depending on how many reactants you have, it gives more and more possibilities of collisions, right? The more you increase it, the probability goes up. So the more things that we introduce, the more possibility of collisions happening. When a collision occurs, the reaction occurs. And that's one of the things that we're trying to happen. Same thing with temperature, right? If you get these molecules and are really excited and kind of running around, it's sort of like if you give a five-year-old a ton of sugar and then they're just running and bouncing all over the place. Chemicals are the exact same way. So when we are looking at these different reactions, well, essentially, if you take, like, let's say, like nitrogen and oxygen here, well, if they collide with each other in the right orientation, meaning they both line up with each other in that horizontal, like I'm showing here above, well, then it will make nitrogen monoxide. But notice that it has to be the right orientation. They have to hit each other, and then the reaction needs to occur. So when it comes to equilibrium, like, this is what's occurring behind the scenes, is that the reactions are coming in contact with each other and having an effect, right? And that's what it's sort of all about. Now, when we go a little bit farther into this, well, when the chemical reaction occurs, I mentioned that it has to have enough energy for it to happen too. It needs to be heated up in a sense. So what this picture shows is this is what we refer to as a potential energy surface. So on the left, you can see the reactants, right? So down here at the bottom, you have nitrogen and oxygen. Now, for them to react, they had to be in the right collision, the right orientation, right? They have to be like a sandwich when they hit each other. Now, the thing about this, though, they need to have enough energy, meaning it has to be moving fast enough for them to smack each other and to react. it needs to have a ton of activation energy. So when we look at these surfaces, they start all the way down here with a little bit of energy all the way at the bottom. And the thing is, they need to essentially climb this big mountain in order for the reaction to happen. So this is what we refer to as a transition state, meaning that it needs to have all this energy, and then in transition to make the products, it will eventually come back down and make products. Now, to get over this hump, it needs to have enough energy to do it. This is a very common picture that you see in biology courses, because when we're referring to enzymes and using catalysts, essentially the whole idea of your body being able to work is that an enzyme will lower this barrier, make the reaction a little easier. So not only does it have to be in like the correct orientation, but it needs to have enough energy for it to happen too. So one thing to keep in mind is the higher this barrier is, the harder it is to happen, the slower it is. And this is where rates come into mind, because essentially they're related to the amount of collisions occurring over the amount of time. So the more energy that's required, the harder it is for it to react. But if you increase the temperature, then it's going to make it a lot easier for these to happen. So this would be more likely to happen at, let's say, boiling, let's say for water boiling, like a water boiling temperature, versus let's say at a freezing or absolute zero where nothing's really moving. That plays a really big effect. In terms of the application of things, this is actually why electric cars and hybrid cars really only work in certain types of environments. One thing that you might realize that if you drive a hybrid, or if you have a friend that even has an electric car, is that they only really work during very, very set of conditions. They kind of like, what the way I always joke with is, they work really well in a Los Angeles based condition because it's always like 70 degrees. But if it's too cold then or too hot, these reactions work off collisions. They are chemical processes that's powering your batteries. So if it's really, really cold out, one thing you're going to see is that the gas efficiency of a hybrid is going to go down. Same thing with the mile range on an electric car. Same thing if it's too hot as well, you'll also see the same idea. In fact, if you kind of actually look at, let's say, like Honda's, since I pulled this off Honda's website for their electric cars, and the one thing that they show is that batteries work by chemical reaction, and the speed of the reaction decreases as the temperature drops, resulting in a temporary decrease in total battery capacity. So they advertise this right to you that, hey, these batteries, they don't quite work all the time. So this is something you got to kind of realize. This is a real world thing. You can see it firsthand, even in terms of how your car works, or even how just regular everyday life works. And now the reverse, when you balanced the chemical reaction, right, you said that there's two HIs behind this thing. If we balance it, what that's telling you is that two of these guys got to collide in order to make the reverse happen. So it's all about how can they line up, how can they collide to make the reactions happen. And that's what the K equations are showing, is, all right, what's the odds that's going to go forward or reverse when it comes to it, right? If it's a really small K value below one, that's telling you that it's going to mainly be reactants, right? That the odds of them running into each other, having enough energy, is not generally occurring. Whereas the forward is kind of like the opposite idea. So if we were to practice this, let's say, to write out some K equations, just so we can see for both the forward and the reverse, could we do that? Well, let's take a look at it. So the first thing that we have to do when it comes to writing a K equation is typically we're looking at either KC or KEQ when we're writing these. So let's just use KC, which is referring just the concentration. So the first thing was that we did the products over the reactants. So we would write our CS2, which is a product. We will put that into brackets. Now, being that it has a coefficient of one, we don't need to worry about writing a power, right? But if you just to show you, right, it would just be a power of one because the coefficient is one. Now with H2 on the products, there are four of them. So what we are going to do is we're going to write a power of four to help illustrate that we have that same power of four that's up here. Oops, that's up here at the top, to help illustrate that you need four of these different things to collide. And the more of them, the more difficult it is for this reaction to happen. Now, on the other side, well, we have our reactant. So we have CH4. We'll put that in brackets. And that's also to a power one. And then we have H2S. And that's to a, and that will be squared. And that's due to the coefficient as well. Now, keep in mind that if you have to write these in like something like MyOpenMath or an auto-graded program, then you don't want to include the ones here. So you just write it just like this to illustrate. This should be for the forward reaction to show the K value. Now, when it comes to the reverse, essentially all we would do is we would put KC, that would be to the negative one to show the backwards. And then all you have to do is pretty much just flip the products and the reactants. So if I take my reactants from before, I would just pretty much just divide that by what products were last time. And we would flip these entire things to show the forward and the reverse, because they are part of the same equation. It's just referring to two different ways to illustrate it. What's the problem asking for? Usually you only ever have to do the top one, but if it ever asks you for the reverse reactions rate, then technically everything needs to flip when you're showing those different processes. Let's go on to our final little tidbits and points about this. Now, the most important thing to really say is that when the rates of the reaction is that the forward rate and the reverse rate, when they're equal to each other, that is when equilibrium is achieved. It is when the rates are the same, meaning that when we're making reactants and when we're making products, when it's essentially, it's not changing anymore on each side in terms of concentration, that is when equilibrium is made. So when we're looking at these, so the last one was on reactants, or sorry, on the rates. This is on the concentrations. The concentrations do not need to be the same. Just to say that again, they don't need to be the same. The only thing that happens is that the rates equal out. So one thing that you can kind of see here is that as the rate, let's say if I look at the forward reaction, and you see the rate is increasing, and then as it goes, the concentration is increasing, but over time, it's just going to stop. The concentration is not going to change anymore. So with these, right, we're looking at the products here, and you can see, hey, this is the same. Versus when we have our reactants, you can see that, okay, it's converting into products, more and more is less reactants, and then all of a sudden it stabilizes. This is when equilibrium is achieved. They do not need to be equal to each other. I can guarantee you that will be a question either on a homework or an exam somewhere. Is that equilibrium is when the rates equal, not when the concentrations. The concentrations can equal each other, but it's very, very, very rare when that situation happens. So when we're kind of looking at these guys, the whole entire thing is all about the collisions that are occurring in terms of the reaction, that over the course of time, we will see reactants are going to be converted to products. So like, for example, if I like look here, I can see I have 8 reactants and no products, and then we can see it's slowly transitioning more and more to products. So eventually, when you see that it's not changing, that's when you know equilibrium is occurring. It's all about like, can you get to that final little piece of where that happens? So if you see no more change, then you made it to equilibrium. And then the final really big point though about all this is that the system is dynamic, meaning it's constantly changing. New conditions are always being applied to the reaction, so it's always going to try to respond to that. So let's try to take a look at this demonstration that I found online for you to watch. And then I'll talk over it so that way you can kind of see how equilibrium works with a real life example. So it's not this hand wavy concept behind the entire process. All right. So in this video, this is from Kevin Dirksen, who's a high school chemistry teacher, and he came up with a really good way to describe equilibrium using a demonstration. So what he's actually showing here is he has a bath essentially with reactants that's completely full, and then with products. And what he's going to be doing with beakers is showing the rate of the reactions. So the reactants are going to be converting to products, and he's going to keep exchanging these things. Now, one thing you notice is that the product beaker is pretty much empty. The reactants one is completely full. So what are you expecting is that, well, over time, you're going to be creating a lot of products as this continues to go. Now, as he keeps transferring, one thing that you're going to be able to see is that, well, with each beaker, he's going to only be able to fill them so much because there's only so much reactant and product available. Now, one thing that you can actually see here is that equilibrium is actually getting achieved right now. Notice how he's transferring both of these at the same exact rate on both sides, and the levels of the containers are not changing anymore. One of them started completely full, the other one started empty. So what this just demonstrates is that equilibrium has occurred where both of the concentrations are actually equal. Notice how they both are transferring 250 milliliters at the same time. So they both have the exact same rate of reaction as they're being transferred. This is equilibrium, right? Even though the forward reaction was being favored throughout the entire beginning, eventually they began to transfer at the exact same rate, which is what we are looking for when we are looking at equilibrium. No matter how much he attempts to do this, there's no possible way for it to ever get out of this state, which is really the really exciting part about this. So let's take a look at his next example with this. Now with this, one thing you can see, it's going to actually equal that chart where you can see the rates are equal to each other. So that's what I was showing you earlier. So this is what it's demonstrating. The rates became equal in terms of the reaction. Now, what if we end up changing the conditions of how we're transferring things? So what if you decided to, on one container, have a bigger beaker, and then on the other one, you wanted to have a really tiny beaker? Meaning like, okay, let's say one side is a little bit more favored than the other. Well, what exactly would happen in terms of that reaction? And that's what he's going to be doing in this next demonstration. So here you can see on the left, he has a 300 milliliter beaker. And on the right, he has about a 150 milliliter beaker. So what he's going to be doing is transferring them. And you can think like, all right, well, there's no possible way that the reactant side is ever not going to lose, right? He's transferring way more liquid at a time on the left-hand side versus the right. Now, the thing about this, though, is depending on how much reactant and product is available, well, he's only going to be able to realistically fill up his reactant beaker so much over time. So notice that now you can kind of see the levels aren't changing anymore. So this is telling you that, oh, he's actually achieving equilibrium. When he zooms in on the beakers, notice that the volumes are the same. So they're both about 140 milliliters. Even though the beakers are different sizes, the rates are now equal to each other. He's transferring at the same rate, 140 milliliters, 140 milliliters each time. He essentially, because of these rates being equal to each other, equilibrium has been achieved, which is incredible to see, right? So with just a simple demonstration, you can see this is how equilibrium would work in a real life application. So let's look at the final chart just to explain this. So in the very end, we can see that equilibrium is finished. And the whole idea here is that, well, the equilibrium is essentially being reached here, and the amounts do not need to be the same for equilibrium to meet, right? So it's just when the rates of the reaction are equal, not necessarily when the concentrations are equal. And that's the important thing to realize. That's the final take home with that. All right. So that's the whole thing with this video. So that's the final end of it. With this, I might be making another practice problem video to help you kind of fully understand all the little intricacies of how to use these. But I hope this kind of filled in the gaps for what exactly is the theory behind the equilibrium process. Thank you so much for listening. I hope that this video helped a little bit try to fill in those little gaps. If you're confused, please feel free to reach out and send me an email, send me a message, or comment below in the video. You can do that too. If you're not one of my normal students and you are watching this video to help you with your class, please hit that like and subscribe button and help the video grow and help the channel grow as well. All right. Thank you so much for listening. This has been Dr. Dan. And if you need more help with chemistry, please let me know. I'll see you all later. Bye now.